Good morning.
Good morning.
Paul, you're live today. Good to see you. Thanks for being here on a hot summer August day. We're glad you're here. If you are a guest, if you're okay, your first time here, there are some guest cards in the pew in front of you. We'd love for you to fill one out and drop it in the offering bag as it comes by. And next week through the mail, we'll send you information that tells you about the New Hope Community Church. We promise not to irritate you or harass you any more than we have to, but we'd love to put information in hands of what goes on around New Hope Church. Let me highlight just a few announcements and some prayer requests that are not in your bulletin, and we will get engaged in our worship. Oh, yeah, I probably, yeah. Can you all, you guys can't hear me? Yeah, I got excited this morning. Here we go. All right. Okay, can you hear me now?
All right, so let me hit some announcements, and then we have another special day. We have another baby dedication today, and those are always exciting times for us. And so let me take care of these things, and we'll get right into to some other important things today. After the service today, you can see Gene Sperling out under the pavilion for two reasons, all right? Number one is you can see him because Grizzly tickets for a game this coming Friday night. It's a Christian testimony night at Grizzly Stadium. And so you get testimonies and music and fireworks at the end. The tickets are $13 for the game. And then you get another game of your choice after that. So when you buy this one ticket, you actually are getting two Grizzly tickets. All right? So see Gene out there, and we've got a section reserved just for us, and there'll be a bunch of us there together, and we can enjoy a good evening. And the weather's supposed to be, on Saturday, it's going to be 93. So Friday night should be cooler, all right? Ought to be an improvement. So we're looking forward to that. You can also see Gene in the pavilion for, not tickets, but you can pay for your seat at the luncheon that's coming up. The poster's on the front door, poster's out in the pavilion. Most of you will not recognize the name Mart Green, but you will recognize the business that he runs, Hobby Lobby. All right, and Mark Green is going to be in town speaking at a luncheon put on by CBMC. We've reserved three tables for folks from New Hope who would like to go. Half of those seats sold last week. So if you would like to go, it's on September the 29th. Information's in your bulletin, but you may get those from Gene today out there. August the 23rd is Africa 1040i Sunday. It will be Mike Cousineau, the director of 1040i, who leads the medical mission trips we go on in February. He will be here in our Sunday morning services. That night, those of us, eight of us, who went to the Ivory Coast of Africa this past February will share some of our pictures and our stories from that trip. And so we hope you'll come and join us that night. And we're trying to get homemade ice cream and cookies for afterwards. All right? So come and join us, and we'll have a good time that day. There's a sign-up sheet coming around. They went around last week, but others may want to sign up today. We'll be starting two new studies and support groups on grief share. If you have experienced loss in your life, whether it's recent or in the past, but you would like some encouragement, you would like some help, you'd like to walk through with a group of other folks, I would heartily recommend grief share to you. Many of our church have been through it. Some have gone through it two and three times because of the difference it makes as they deal with the issues of loss and grief. For the very first time, we're offering it in the daytime as well as a nighttime. So there's a Tuesday morning one that will be from 9:30 to 11:30 and a Wednesday evening from 6:30 to 8:30. Those will start on August the 18th and August the 19th. If you put your name and contact information on here, someone will contact you, answer your questions, and see if this is going to be something that would be helpful for you to go through. August the 16th. 2 weeks from today, we're going to be having communion in our Sunday morning services, so giving you a heads up. And this afternoon, after our last service, our homeless outreach will meet over in the Jam Center in the Surf Room and prepare the lunches and then head out as a team to provide some care and compassion for the homeless in our area. There are some prayer requests that are not in your bulletin, and let me highlight those quickly. Last Sunday, I had a chance to introduce to you to Tyler and Elaine Stearns, a young couple in our community had struggled for several years trying to have a baby, went through lots of surgeries and procedures, finally got pregnant. Their baby was born very, very premature, 1 pound, 1 ounce, 11 inches long, lived 3 weeks, 5 days, and 3 minutes. And we had that memorial service last Monday. And so we'd appreciate you remembering to pray for Tyler and Elaine as they go through the process of the next several months. Highland Kaufman, who attends our 8 o'clock service, her 90-year-old aunt passed away, and we had memorial services yesterday. And her sister from Texas was in our 8 o'clock service this morning. So just remember the Kaufman family. Caroline Weaver, her husband is one of Clovis' finest. Her mom passed away, and those services will be this coming Saturday. Her name is Margaret Orr. Bill Ladd, my father-in-law, as we shared with you last week, has stage 3 lung cancer. The only treatment really possible for him because of his health is comfort care. So they're going to be doing treatment that will help give him as much comfort as possible. So please be praying for our family. Orville Little, you've heard me talk about Orville over the years. Just used him in a couple of sermon illustrations recently. He is Janet Mattson's father, longtime resident here of Clovis, and Orville went home to be with the Lord yesterday. He is now in heaven. He had been under hospice care for about 10 days. Those services will be 2 weeks from yesterday, so I think that's the 15th. Is that right? Yeah, August the 15th. More information on that later. Jackie Hopelian, part of our church family. Her 93-year-old dad, Jack Scott, passed away this last week. And his services are going to be here 3 weeks from yesterday on August the 23rd. Jerry Brown, who normally sits right here on this row. All right, you guys are sitting in Jerry's spot today, but that's all right. He's not here. Jerry's had a lot of heart complications over the last several years. Couple of open heart surgeries, several stents. His heart is not in great shape. Every time they go in, they say, may not make this one. Well, they said it again Friday, okay, yesterday. Went in and they said, boy, we really can't do surgery and we can't do open heart for sure. We really shouldn't do a stent, but they did 2 stents because they said we can't do nothing. He rested well last night, got a call and a message from Sonny this morning, said he had a good night's rest and he's looking better today, so we're grateful for that. Continue to pray for Daniel Haynes. And then my nephew Andrew, Janice's son, went to ER yesterday with stomach issues. They're running a bunch of tests and still waiting for some answers. So if you would remember them. Mikey Zumwalt continues to do well and recovering from her knee, and we're so grateful for that. And Teresa Hutchinson flew Friday morning, mid-morning, and is on the next leg of her journey. So continue to pray for Teresa. So those are some of the updates that we wanted to share with you today. Thanks for being here. And we get to share in something very, very special. I am going to ask if Maddox Christopher Woods would bring his mom and dad up here. All right? Yes. Oh, okay. Okay. I'm going to hand this mic to you so they can hear any comments that you might make. All right, come stand right here. Yes, you may come and get right in the middle, right in the middle. All right. Oh, you got a photographer right here. Good, good. Dylan's going to help out. So take the cap off. Okay. Grandparents who are here, grandparents, would you come on up and stand next to your son and your daughter and your grandson? All right. I know that they're here, all right, and the rest of the folks on these front two rows are family, okay, and they are here to celebrate this with them as well. So come right on up, guys. All right. Maddox, you are a handsome dude. Yes, you are. Whichever mom or dad are going to speak, all right, tell us the date of his birth, what he weighed when he showed up in this world, and how long he was at that moment.
He was 7 pounds, 11 ounces. He was born at 10:06 a.m. And he was, around 20 inches long.
Okay. Now, were you up all night? I mean, 10 something, that's a great time to have a baby.
Yeah.
Were you up all night, or did you just go in that morning?
Oh, and no, I was up all night.
You were up all night. Okay. Oh, yeah. All right. Yeah. Good.
It wasn't good. Bad, though.
Good. Dad, how tough was it on you that day?
It wasn't bad.
Easy. All right. Piece of cake. Good.
He wasn't bad.
Okay, the man standing next to you says, no. Okay.
Okay, fine, I could have one more baby.
Well, your family has been blessed with a beautiful daughter, and she is so, so sweet. And now you have been blessed with a handsome son, and I guess you could say life just doesn't get better than this. A good marriage, a beautiful little girl and a beautiful little boy. You all have been at New Hope long enough that you know, oh, he's seeing his picture up there. Doesn't take long, all right? We love pictures of ourselves. But Mom and Dad, this day is really not about you dedicating your son as much as it is your son is dedicating the two of you. And so I have a couple of questions for the two of you. I know that you will take care of him physically. There is no question about it. I know your parents. They will see to it. All right, hey, there may be the next pastor at New Hope. That would be awesome. That'll be, he looks so comfortable there. All right, get that picture, Dylan. Get that picture. All right, good. Actually, I'm not much taller than he is. It's why I have a clear podium, all right? So, Mom and Dad, here's the questions for the two of you. I know you'll take care of him physically, and I know that you'll see that he gets a good education. He'll know math and science. But here's what I want to know from the two of you. Are you going to see that he knows as much as he possibly can about who Jesus Christ is? If you're willing to see that he gets a biblical knowledge and education at home and at church, would you say, we will?
We will.
We will.
Good. Will you pray for him every day, and will you give him the freedom to follow God's leadership in his life? If you're willing to do that, would you say, we will?
We will. We will.
Grandparents, as you stand on each side of them, you're a vital part of what your kids do with their grandkids. Will you encourage them not only in the emotional and the physical and the educational part of the development of your grandson, but will you encourage them also in the spiritual development of his life as well? If you're willing to do that, would you as grandparents say, we will?
We will.
Terrific. Hey, come here, Maddox. When they get this old, sometimes they like to do their own thing. Yeah, that's okay. I'm glad he's not shy. Mr. Maddox, would you come see me a minute? Would you come see me a minute? You are handsome. Look at it. All those people. Can you wave at him? Can you wave? You're going to get shy now? Okay. I'm going to ask Mom and Dad and grandparents, would you all join hands together? And I want you to put, I'm going to stand right like this. One hand on one shoulder. You put one hand on his other shoulder. And we're going to make a little chain as we pray for Mr. Maddox here. All right? Let's pray. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you so much for this beautiful boy who stands right here with his mom and his dad. And Lord, he's got a pacifier now, so he's very content. We thank you for his life. We have no idea what the direction is going to be for him from this moment on. But we know your word says that you have plans and you have purposes for him. You will never force him to do your will. But Father, again and again, you'll reveal that will to him. And our desire is that he will choose your leadership in his life. Thank you for his mom and dad who have a love for you and an interest in you. And Father, thank you that you'll give them wisdom to know how to best share with their son and their daughter the love and the life of Jesus Christ. Thank you for grandparents who will help them with their care, who will support them in the decisions that they make. And we pray for an incredible future. May one day he not just stand behind this podium, but may one day his life be a message for you. We commit this to you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Hey, he's just talking to that one back there. All right? They're talking to each other. Over here. Okay. I have two things for you. One, he's probably a little bit old for quilts, but he might still enjoy carrying them around. But this is one that is made by the women of New Hope. There's a little note on the corner of this that says, God loves you, made for you with love by New Hope Community Church. Some of the women in the church made that. And so that is just for Maddox. And then a certificate that you can say, hey, I can show you the pictures and I can show you the certificate. We entrusted you to the love of the Lord. So thank you so much for sharing Maddox with us today. God bless you guys. Thank you. Oh, my pleasure, Chris. You're making a good dad, buddy.
Thank you.
Good job. Bless you. All right. Who knew when we married them a few years ago that they could have such beautiful kids? All right? A nine. It's a nine? You were just a baby. Oh, awesome. Wow. Time passes. Great, great family. Beautiful kids. Guys, I'm going to ask you to stand. Our ushers are going to come wait on us today. We're going to pray. As soon as we pray, you may be seated. We're going to watch a little longer than normal video this morning, okay? But this one packs a good punch today. So would you join us as we pray? Father, thank you for the life that we get to share with you. It's a life that you wish to share with us 24/7. And so we say thanks. Father, I commit to you what's given today. It's given not out of compulsion or out of force, but Father, it's given as a testimony that we believe in who you are. We believe in the resurrection of your Son, the Lord Jesus, and we believe that, Father, you can do more with our less than we can do with our all. And so we give it to you hilariously today, and may it be used for the advancement of your kingdom. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. You may be seated.
Don't show the video quite yet.
Ephesians 2.
So we are going to do something a little bit different. We're tasked to change things up a little bit. So this video is quite a bit longer, as Pastor Tim said, but it's really powerful. One of the things that I tell the worship team is that we don't perform. And the next song after this video, it's a new song for you, but Shelly, Amanda, the team are going to lead us in this song. You may have heard it on K-Love or the radio somewhere. By all means, join us in that song. There are some songs, and I will choke up when I watch you guys just stand. I'm not that way. This song is one of those hands open and just worship God songs. However, when the video is over, we're just going to go right into the song. So that's why I've brought the worship team up, and we didn't rehearse that part. So by all means, enjoy the video.
Ephesians 2:10 says that we are God's workmanship, his masterpiece. I don't know about you, but when I get up in the morning and look in the mirror, I don't really see a masterpiece, you know? I mean, maybe a Picasso. It's like, but I want to be his masterpiece. I want to be everything he created me to be. And so I go to him in prayer and I say, Dear Heavenly Father, do whatever it takes to mold me into the image of your Son. Make me your masterpiece. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Hi.
Whoa. Who are you?
I'm God. You said the prayer, so here I am.
You're not God.
No, I am. You said the prayer. That's how it works.
Okay. If you're God, then make it snow in here.
You know what? I really don't want to make it snow in here because it'd get kind of yucky.
Yeah, you're not God.
Why do you say that?
God wouldn't say yucky.
I do. It's a Greek word.
Oh. Okay. If you're God, what does Lamentations 15:9 say?
Lamentations is only 5 chapters. It's a very short book.
Oh, why was it so short?
I was tired of lamenting.
Oh, okay. If you're God, who's going to win the World Series this year?
I'm really not into playing games. Why are you so much into playing games?
You are God.
What gave it away?
You answered my question with a question.
I did? Yeah, I do that, don't I? I did it again. Step right up. Here we go.
Okay.
All right.
Hey, what are we doing?
I'm going to make you into my original masterpiece. This is the process.
Oh, okay. Got it.
Yeah.
Wait. What are these about?
These are the tools I'm going to use to make you into my original masterpiece.
Okay. Yeah. Hang on.
Yeah.
I thought you were a carpenter.
That's my son. Step right up. Here we go.
Okay. Oh, hey, God.
Mm-hmm.
How do you know what to chisel away and what to leave?
I take out everything in your life that doesn't belong there, kind of like dead weight.
Ooh, speaking of dead weight, could you chisel right here? It showed up when I was in my 20s and grew around and became back fat. I don't even know why you created that, but I can't get rid of it. I mean, I've tried everything. Like, I tried running, I tried lifting weights. My wife actually talked me into trying Pilates. That was awkward, but I can't get rid of it. So if you would just chisel around here, and then, you know what, if you chisel a line right here and maybe 4 to 5, maybe 8 lines right here. That would be awesome.
You're funny.
You made me that way.
I also made the platypus.
Oh, the platypus.
All I'm saying is most of my children, when it comes to this process, they just want to talk, but they don't want to do the work. So do you want to talk or can I chisel? Talk, chisel,
no,
talk,
no,
chisel.
No. I choose to chisel.
All right. Through my Holy Spirit, I'm going to bring up things in your life that I want you to work on. Like your anger. I created the emotion, but you use it in the wrong way. You compare yourself to others instead of me. You tell little white lies because you want to people please. You're lazy. But you try to fool everybody by looking really, really busy. You have a problem with lust? Well,
time out. I don't really have a problem with lust.
You don't have a problem with lust.
No, I can do it anytime I want. Hang on a second. I mean, I got to admit, I feel like you've been doing some great work, and I'm looking pretty good right now.
All right, when you look in the mirror, who do you see?
I see me.
Okay, then I need to keep chiseling away because ultimately you and other people need to see my son.
Okay, don't misunderstand me. It's just when I look more like Jesus, people get uncomfortable around me. I mean, even my church friends, and they're like, oh, you're holier than thou, you know? And I don't think I'm supposed to make people uncomfortable.
So what you're saying is you'd rather play God in certain areas of your life than for me to be God over your whole life.
That is not what I said.
It's what you meant.
Yes, it is. It's hard to talk to you. You know everything that I'm thinking. I'm just saying you've done some great work. Maybe we take a break, a sabbatical from each other, you know. I'll stay right here and then, you
know. That's just it. You never just stay right there. You're either moving toward me or away from me, but never you just stay. What you're doing is called control. Do you want to control things or life, or can I chisel? Control, chisel, control,
chisel. No, chisel, chisel.
All right.
But can we chisel where I want?
That's called control.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
Now this right here, this secret sin that you keep running to whenever you're hurting, angry, lonely, tired, that you think you're fooling everybody, but it's making you a whitewashed tomb. Are you ready for me to chisel this out of your life?
Yeah.
You see, it's a process. It's not a sprint, it's a marathon. It's your whole life. And you care so deeply about what other people think of you. It's rubbish. It's garbage. The greatest thing you're ever going to hear is at the end of your life when you hear me say, well done, good and faithful servant. That's what you keep your eye on. That's the prize, heavenward.
Oh, that hurts.
Oh, trust me, this hurts me more than it hurts you.
Right. Okay, I'm sorry. I don't think you understand this pain.
Pardon me?
You're asking me to sacrifice a lot, God.
Don't talk to me about sacrifice. I know all about sacrifice. I sent my son to die on the cross for pain, for sin, but I also did it for another reason, to give you freedom. Do you know what insanity is? Insanity is doing the same thing over and over and over again, expecting different results. And there are things that you've been doing for years, these empty wells that don't have anything to offer. You've been going to them and it's insane. Allow me to chisel them out of your life. Allow me to produce character where you keep focusing so much on your image.
Okay, but I was thinking.
Your thoughts are not my thoughts.
Okay, but if we went another way.
Your ways are not my ways.
Oh, I can't.
You can't what?
I can't be good.
That's your excuse. That's your excuse, is that you can't be good.
It's not an excuse. I can't.
Oh, my child. In the beginning, I said it was good. I made you good. Be good.
Yeah, but you and I both.
What?
Nothing.
No, what is it?
Nothing, okay? You wouldn't understand.
I, God of all the universe, wouldn't understand something one of my children has to say. Try me.
It's just, I let you down so many times, God.
No, my child. You were never holding me up. I hold you up with my victorious, righteous right hand. Never the other way around. In this relationship, I hold you up.
Okay. And chisel away. Just be prepared for what you're gonna find in there. Because I know who's inside there. Because I get up every morning and I look at him in the mirror, and I hate who I see. Because deep inside there, this little kid who gets up every morning and dresses like an adult. And I go out and I try to do what I'm supposed to do, but I can't, okay? I can't be who everybody else expects me to be. God, I can't even be who I want to be, much less who you created me to be. And so inside is this scared, stupid little kid. But you chisel away, just be prepared.
You have listened to so many voices for far too long that were not from me. And you have totally bought into the lie, haven't you? You think you're junk, don't you? When you lay your head down at night after you've done the dance to get the hug, you think you're junk. Listen to me. I don't take time to make junk. How can I show you that my love for you stretches as far as the east to the west? How can I show you that my love for you has no end? I know. Reach in your back pocket.
What?
Reach in your back pocket.
Why?
Are you arguing with me? Reach in your back pocket.
Oh, God.
Yes?
I just meant, God, I'll do that right now.
You're just saying my name in vain.
Come on. It's a name. It's a saying.
It's a name above all names. It's more than a saying. It's more than a name. I want to teach you something about my name. Reach in your back pocket.
Oh, my God. Shh.
You know what that is?
Yeah, it's a note. I wrote it when I was in college. How did you get this?
Hello?
Oh, yeah.
Go ahead, read it.
I love Angie.
Other side.
Sorry. Dear God, did I hear you right today? Did I hear you say that you love me? Even though you and I both know I've messed up so many times. Did I hear you say you want to use me? And I feel so useless. If you'll take me and use me, then God, I give you all that I am. Take me. I love you, God.
I love you too. And I love you too much just to leave you where you're at. This salvation that you hold, I don't want it to be some sentimental gush or some head knowledge. I want you to work it out in every detail of your life. And when problems come and chaos happens, don't look at it as a prison, but look at it as a father disciplines his child. A father disciplines the ones he loves.
I know, but it's gonna be tough.
Yes, but you bought into the lie thinking everything was gonna be easy when you gave everything over to me. There will be trouble in this world, but be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. I want you to do something. I want you to look out there and I want you to say, Tommy is God's original masterpiece.
Tommy is God's.
No, not the way you see yourself or you try so desperately for others to see you, but maybe for the first time in your life, the way I see you, the way I created you.
Tommy is God's original masterpiece.
Yes, you are.
And so are you. God doesn't make junk. You are an original masterpiece.
Thank you all so much for singing that song. I heard it for the very first time at the World Day of Prayer over at Mountain View Church. And I was so moved by it, and I said, Milo, we got to sing it. Didn't know that two or three other people had been telling Milo, we need to sing that song. And what a great video you chose today, Milo, and it's perfect for today. If you've been here for the last 3 or 4 weeks, you know we're engaged in a series. It's called Twisted and Unseen. And this became a series that really birthed out of the events that I feel like that we are facing as a nation. If you were here on July 4th weekend, Sunday, July 5th, it was a bit of an unusual service. And we did some things certainly very, very differently. But we looked at 2 Chronicles and looked at the recipe that God gave to Solomon about how does a nation which has grown far away from God, how do we personally and how do we collectively return not only ourselves and our fellowship, but a nation back to God? We looked at what was going on in our society a bit, and we're trying to figure out what's the cause. What's the root problem that has taken us from where we once were as a nation, known as a godly nation, and now known as a nation that is not godly? How did that happen? So we've started a series called Twisted and Unseen, looking at how just as germs, an invisible germ that we can't see without a microscope, can actually impact our visible world with sickness and disease and death, there is also an unseen world the Bible talks about. It says, we wrestle not, we battle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and rulers of darkness and the prince of the air of this world. And Jesus gave the prince of this world a name, and his name is Satan. And he exists, and he's functional in this world. And he takes the truth of God, and with subtle twists, he gets us away from the truth. That problem started in the Garden of Eden and exists today. And so we wrestle against unseen forces in this world. And that's not to make us spooky. It's not to make us sound crazy. It's to make us aware that what the battle is not against things that we can take care of in a ballot box. These are things that will be changed only through prayer and the leadership of God in our lives. And the video hit on it. The song just nailed it. And today we're going to look at a subject I really don't like to preach about, but yet it's a big elephant in the room and what we're facing right now. When the Supreme Court made their decision earlier this year, it once again changed our national perspective of what sex is all about. I will not be graphic today, but just so you know, I'm going to talk about sex. If you have kids that are probably under 10, you make a decision if you need to take them over to Sunday school, all right? I highly suspect if they're 10 and older, they know a whole lot more than you think they know about the subject. That is probably obvious. And what we're going to look at today is the twist by this one who is unseen and how he has distorted our personal and our national views on this most important subject. You see, here's the twist. We have bought into the deception that sex is only physical. That's the twist, that it's only physical. It's just an event. It's just an act. It's just a moment in time. And you see, I'm 60. It's taken me 5 months to say that boldly. I'm 60, which means I grew up in the counterculture of the 60s and the 70s with the influence and the rhetoric of free love, free sex, and free dope. We didn't want to pay for anything. It was all out there for us. And in spite of growing up in that culture, I'm still absolutely convinced that what the Bible has to say about sex is not only true and it's not only relevant, but beyond that, it is just basic common sense and it's really good advice. Even if you don't believe that the Bible is the inspired Word of God, there is something that the Scripture says. In fact, there's insights in the Bible that we'll look at today that modern psychiatrists and psychologists have in their terminology, but it was already existing 2,000 years ago. It is so incredibly relevant that as old-fashioned as some of what I'm going to say today may sound, I think it's still worth talking about. But here's going to be the pushback. Every time I talk about this subject, and I don't talk about it often. In fact, the last time I talked about it was 2 years ago. Some of you are going to say, wow, he talks about that all the time. 2 years ago. 2 years ago, okay? I hadn't talked about it in 2 years. And do you know when I talked about it before that? Never from the pulpit. A lot in college group. We used to have a college group in our home. That's all they ever wanted to talk about, all right? So we talked about it a lot then, but never from the pulpit. And I had to repent over my infrequent discussion of the subject from the Bible, from the pulpit, to impact the church family. And see, I know that what people are going to say is you're going to feel like, wow, you've gone back into Old Testament times and you're listening to an Old Testament prophet who's out in the wilderness crying, don't do it! Don't do it! And everybody's going to say, Could you get a new preacher at that church? I mean, he's Rip Van Winkle. He's been asleep for 200 years. I mean, nobody thinks this way anymore. It seems like this is going to be a waste of time. And I'll be honest, I don't think for a minute that after this message is over, a whole lot's going to change. Most of us will probably just walk out the door, back into our culture, and we'll go, well, that was kind of interesting today. I'm glad so-and-so didn't come today, but what would we expect? He's a preacher. Many will think that what the Scripture says about this subject is impractical and irrelevant, but I believe, and I really think in your heart of hearts, except maybe for the most calloused of individuals, there's something that rings true about this for all of us. As impractical as it may sound, so every once in a while, as a pastor, I feel like I need to be a prophet, and I need to say, okay, let me say this one more time. Here is what the Bible says about sex. Not what does the school book say, not what does the Supreme Court say, but what does the Bible say about sex? And today, I'm not going to look at all the specifics. I'll highlight. What I'm going to do is give you a few verses that you can check out on your own, all right? But we're going to look at this, the key subject, all right? What's behind it, what the intent was. And that satisfies, for me, so many of the arguments. But if you want to know everything God has to say about sex, let me give you three passages. Exodus chapter 20, all right? How many of you know what you'll find in Exodus chapter 20? Ten Commandments, yeah. Ten Commandments are there, and all Ten Commandments are not about sex, all right, but a couple of them are. And one of them says, thou shalt not commit adultery, yeah. And I don't have time today, but that word adultery there in the Hebrew is an umbrella word, all right? There's a couple of different words in the Old Testament. We have adultery. Most of us know adultery. It's a married person who's having sex with somebody who's not a married person, or they're married to somebody else, all right? That's adultery. But this term there in the Old Testament also covers the subject, a word that we almost think is vulgar because we don't say it anymore, but it's a word called fornication. And fornication is sex between two single people who aren't married to anybody. That's fornication. Then we have adultery. So it's covered there in Exodus chapter 20. There's a lot of other verses. I'm just going to give you three. Romans chapter 1. You want to know what God thinks about the Supreme Court decision of same-sex marriage? And a lot of people, even a lot of Christians, will try to tell you the Bible is unclear on the subject. No, it's not. Doesn't mean we have to be unkind. Doesn't mean we have to be mean. But the Bible is not unclear. It is very, very clear. Romans chapter 1 will explain that to you. And then 1 Corinthians chapter 6, where we're going to be reading from in just a few minutes. All right? And it's very, very clear as it lays all this out. One former youth pastor who has become a senior pastor now, very large congregation back east, he tells the following personal story. He said, some adults used to hang out in the back of our youth service when I preached on the subject of sex. They used to come in and hang out anyway because they liked the music, but anytime I preached on sex, some of the young adults wanted to come and be in there with us. One lady who had been married and was now divorced, she was in her early 30s. She was into the whole single scene, and she was very, very attractive. And after the message that day, she tracked me down and she said, hey, just a minute, Pastor, I've got a quick question for you. And he said, yeah. She said, hey, it's about this sex thing. I got to pause right there. I got to tell you, that's a really weird way to start a conversation with a pastor. I'm just telling you, all right? Hey, I got a question. It's about that sex thing. All right? Don't do that in front of anybody, please, all right? And she said, now here's what I want to know. What you said today, that's just for teenagers, right? It's just for the teenagers. It's not for me, right? And this pastor looked at her and said, excuse me, I'm not sure I get your drift. She said, you know, this whole wait until you're married, that's for teenagers, right? I mean, when you're my age and, you know, I'm dating, I'm kind of out there in the world, I'm a little older now. I mean, surely what you said about no sex, that doesn't apply to my stage of life, right? And he said, she asked this with the utmost sincerity. And that is one of those moments that we as pastors have where people will stop us after we've preached a 35 or 40-minute sermon, and they want to ask us a complicated question, and all they want is a 10-second soundbite answer. So this pastor said, at that moment I prayed, and I said, God, I need a soundbite. I don't have 20 minutes to discuss this. And he said, out of nowhere, my brain popped a question. And he said, I've used this question hundreds of times since then. And he looked at the young lady and he said, ma'am, here's a question for you. Has sex outside of marriage made your life better or just more complicated? That's almost a below-the-belt question, isn't it? She teared up immediately and she whispered, more complicated. I said, that's why this is not just for teenagers. It's for everybody. Now, you know what's weird about this subject? It's almost stupid to have to talk about it, because if we could just pause for a minute and don't even bring the Bible into it yet, let's just be citizens for a moment and look at our culture. If we would all just get together and ask this question, hey, is this working for you? Are you better off? Are you happier? Are the children in our society healthier and wholesome? Are more people staying together? Are more marriages lasting longer? Has it helped the economy? You don't need a preacher to tell you that it just makes your life and your family and your soul and your brain and your relationships more complicated when you take this incredible gift of sex that God has given to us, and we rip it out of the context that God designed it for. And when you just put it out there and it becomes random, and you just kind of go with your feelings, or you say, kids will be kids, boys will be boys. How come nobody ever says girls will be girls? It's always the boys. And who cares what I look at? Because, hey, I'm not hurting anybody else. This is just me. What we know, you don't need to tell me. What we know is it's not making our life better. It's not, is it? And I don't even know all of you, and I know it's not. You just wish like crazy you could just kind of turn off part of your psyche and part of your soul when you walk down the concourse into the airport as you're on your way to travel for work. You just wish there was a part of you you could leave at home so it would stay right within the context of your marriage. But you know what? This has become a pattern for you, and it's difficult and it's distracting, and you hate it. You hate it in some ways what you've become. You hate what you have filled your mind with. You don't like it, and you know it's not working. Some parents don't get to put their kids to bed at night because sex got in the way. Some have been so sexually active before they got married, and this is so common. So maybe this will help you because you think you're the only one. Guys, I got to tell you, you know I do quite a few weddings every year, and they're not all folks who are from our church, and I get criticized by some pastor friends. You married that couple who's living together? Don't you want them to get married? And I don't berate them. I don't even have them fill out a questionnaire that says, hey, are you guys living together before you get married? One, it's usually pretty obvious, pretty quick. We open a door and we begin to talk about how does spirituality impact their future marriage. There's a chapter in the book, and I say, there's a chapter in the back. It's called sex, Most people don't want to talk to the pastor about it, but it's there, and if it's open, we'll dialogue. And often they'll say, hey, we just want to be honest with you. We're living together. And I say, okay. That's not between you and me. That's between you and God. I'd be happy to talk about it. But I'm happy. I'm glad you're making this step to get married. You see, a lot of folks are doing it. But Tim, it just makes sense. I mean, it's kind of like test driving a car first, right? Let's see if this works. You know, that works really well when you buy the car. That works really well when you marry that. But what happens if you have to test drive 4 or 5 cars? See, you don't want to talk about more complicated? And what happens in one of those test drives of a brand new car and you wreck it? What happens when you test drive a relationship and a baby shows up? What happens when you test drive a relationship and an STD shows up? What happens? You get married. And you remember, man, before we got married, he was hot. She was so sensual. And, man, our life was great. And now you're married, and 4 or 5 months later, wow. Boy, you changed a lot. You're just not in. You're not hot anymore. This is not working. Let's all face up to something. The way we approach this subject, this three-letter word, the way we market it, the way we use it to advertise, the way it's used in so much music, and the way it's portrayed. Come on. This idea, hey, if it seems right, it really isn't helping us, is it? It really doesn't work. We're not better off. We have bought into a lie, and we're paying the price. It doesn't make life better. It makes our life more complicated. The thing that's really the ripoff is that the decisions that some have made, and some of us have made when we were 18 and 19 and 20-year-olds, those freshman year in college, and all that stuff, it didn't make our lives worse often right then. It wasn't that stage in life when it got worse. It made our lives worse in the next stage of life. If you're single and you're in here this morning, you're in this whole dating thing and you've kind of bought into, hey, it's okay to do anything I want to. I'm an adult. Here's what I got to let you know. If it feels like it's working now, here's a heads up. A couple of relationships down the road and in another stage of your life, you'll discover it didn't work and it never was working. Your life will not be better. Your life will be more complicated. Now, if you were God, and just by the way, in case you didn't know this, you're not. But if any of us were God, and as God, we saw what we see today. We see the child abuse. We see the human trafficking. We see the millions of children growing up without parents because of the misapplication of sex. If you were to go back and pick the top news stories over the last couple of years, the ones that you really went to work and talked about, hey, did you hear about, did you read about, even just ones in this past week and a half, I'm going to say 80 to 90% of them have some kind of sexual component. It's like every single day on news, it illustrates to us it's not working. It's broken. It's damaged. So if you were God and you saw all of this, what would you say to all of us Earthians? I made that word up this week. What would you say to all the Earthians? What kind of advice would you give them about sex? Hey, Earthians, you need to be careful, you need to be safe, you need to be responsible. Sound familiar? Is it working? No. I think if you were God and saw all of this, and as God, you were able to see into all the souls and all the hearts and all the struggles that they have with intimacy and the struggles in marriage. If you could see the ghosts that follow people around in their marriage, the abuse they got as a child, and now they're trying to do intimacy as an adult. If you were God and you could have everybody's attention and make one statement about sex, what do you think God would say if he loved you? I believe he would say exactly the opposite of what our culture has told you and me. Because culture, here's a news flash, if you haven't figured this one out yet, culture is trying to make a buck. God loves you. But our society is trying to get a dollar out of this. But God loves us. So he says something radically different. It's an old-fashioned message. But I don't even need to read anything out of the Bible to tell you that what we're doing right now isn't working, because we all pay a price every single day for a bad perspective of this incredible gift. But I talk to people as a profession, as a pastor. I talk to a lot of people who wish they could go back and miss out on some things that they did earlier in their life. You know why? Forget the Bible for a second. They wish they could go back and miss out on some choices they made, because what they've discovered in this stage of life is what they did then didn't work. It did not work. Nobody looks back. Nobody has ever sat in my office and said, Pastor Tim, gosh, if I could have just slept with more people, my life would have been better. God, Pastor, I got to tell you, if I could have just had more and different, it would have been really good for me. I've never had anybody say, you know, Pastor, the reason I'm struggling today is because of a lack of partners. Now, you know why? Nobody says that, because they all know it's a lie. Why can something that so obviously be so severely missed in our world? Why is it if I were to stand out in the middle of town with a big sign that says, sex is for married people, people would drive by, maybe you included, and say, good grief, can't they arrest that idiot? You see, it's because we're so twisted. We're all paying a price. Our kids, they're really going to pay the price in the next generation. Every once in a while, I've got to put my prophet hat on and come out here, and I need to say what's obvious. Sex is for married men and women. It's not okay just because I'm 18 or 21. It's not okay just because, hey, it's my second time around and I'm 50. Let me see if I can illustrate this in another way. It's like fire. A fire is good inside the boundaries of a campfire. Fire is good inside my barbecue pit. When I go camping, there's nothing I enjoy more than sitting around a campfire, all right? Warming my feet, backing up my backside to it, all right? And enjoy staring into the fire, which if you're a good cowboy, you never stare into a fire, all right? That's how you get shot, okay? Because you're blinded when you look up. But we don't worry about that anymore. But that's what I love to do at a campfire. But you know what? What would it be like if somebody grabbed one of those burning sticks out of the fire and went running through the woods? Sparks flying everywhere. We know what happened at Bass Lake, don't we? When a 15-year-old played with fire outside of the boundaries in which it was intended. I enjoy fire so much that Shelly and I, on sale at Orchards, bought a fire pit. We don't have to go camping to enjoy a fire pit. We go on our patio and sit down and enjoy our fire pit. But that fire pit does not belong in the middle of my living room. See, there's a problem there. Please don't miss this. This wonderful thing called a campfire becomes extraordinarily destructive when it's outside its boundaries. This thing called, this wonderful thing called sex becomes extraordinarily destructive outside its boundaries. Now, before you get all bent out of shape at me, and maybe it's too late for me to say that, because I'm the preacher, and what would you expect a preacher to say if you don't hear anything else? Hear this. This is the starting point for you as you start rethinking your attitude about this subject. God created it. God brought the matches to the campfire. God stacked the first pile of wood. He poured on a gallon of kerosene. You don't believe that? Go back to Genesis. Scripture says God created Eve and he brought her to Adam and he said, Adam, behold your wife. Go for it. That is the Tim Rowland 21st century modern translation, all right? But it means the same thing. Here is what it goes. You can go read it. It'll be just like this in your Bible. God said to Adam, go, be fruitful, multiply, replenish the earth. I don't know about you, but that sounds like go for it to me. God, with all of his created angels in heaven, God probably looked at those angels and said, hey, you like the sun, the moon, and the stars? Watch this. And he throws the match on Adam and Eve. Whoosh! And those angels are like, whoa, we've seen lions and tigers, but man, a man and a woman, whoa, we've never seen that. God's going, I made that from nothing. I started with nothing and I created sex. Look at that. Is that not unbelievable? And the angels are looking on going, God, wished I was human. Actually, I don't know if they really said that. I just think probably they did. So I want you to read three verses with me this morning. Because why do we need to preach on this? I think it's obvious. I think it's kind of like don't forget to eat, and don't forget to breathe. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Here's what Paul said. Paul had planted a church in the town of Corinth, a culture where they thought sex was just an activity. That's the twist. See, that's what we're buying into today, what the community of Corinth bought into back then. It's just an activity. Go there, have a little sex, go back home. Go over there, have a little, go back home. Get in front of your computer, have a little, go back home. Just an activity, something you do. It's a hobby. Paul drops into a culture that believed that lie. In fact, they believed that lie so much. In that culture, you could go to the temple on the Sabbath, worship a pagan deity, have sex with a temple prostitute, pay for it, go home, have lunch with the kids, and go to a soccer game. That's what they did in that culture. I don't know about the soccer game, but everything else. Read the whole chapter of 1 Corinthians 6. You want to see our Sunday school grow? Let's change our Sunday school classrooms from Sunday school rooms to bedrooms and say as an act of worship. we'd probably be the biggest church in town in about 6 months. That's what was going on in Corinth. Why? Because the twist was they saw it as just an act. Here's God's take on the whole thing. Verse 18. Flee. Pretty strong word here. Flee. Run hard from sexual immorality. Now, unfortunately, what we almost have to do today is define what immorality is. I know, flee sexual immorality. Run from it. Don't flirt with it. Don't get as close as you can. Don't entertain yourself with it. Run from it. Here's why we have to define it today. See, if you're here today, I say this kindly, if you're here today and you're living together, you look at this verse, and I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, that's right, we all have to run from it. But this isn't immorality. What I am in is not immorality. You're married, and you've got a girlfriend or a boyfriend on the side. You really love both of these people very much. You love your family. You don't want to wreck it, but man, this other person completes something that your family is not. And you guys have this cool song together, and you know what? It's a secret, and everything's going to be okay. There's some guilt, but it's okay. You see the flee sexual immorality, and you say, I understand, I agree, but what I'm doing is not immoral. You've got an internet habit, and you're going, yeah, I think everybody ought to flee sexual immorality. I don't think, though, this is immoral. It's just me. You see, we live in a culture where we redefine the words. So real quickly, just remember what the Bible says is immoral. In fact, if you want to back up from verse 18 to verse 9 in the same chapter, do you know that the wicked will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, Paul said. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor male prostitutes. That doesn't mean female prostitutes get a pass, okay? It's just male prostitutes were really unusual. Everybody understood, all right, the other side. They didn't understand this side. So next, nor homosexual offenders. Is that unclear? Nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And this next line is what's so big. And that is what some of you, read the word, were. Every one of those may have been what you once were, but you don't have to still be what you once were. But you were washed and you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus by the Spirit of our living God. It's not that God goes ballistic over sexual sin versus other sins. That's not the point he's about to make here. The reason sexual sin is in a category all of its own is because of the way this sin impacts you more than it impacts God. None of those sins impact him more than the other. He sent his son to die on a cross for every single one of them. But sexual sins will linger long, the effects of sexual sins will linger long after the effects of telling a lie. Sexual sins will linger long after stealing something from somebody. And we'll find out why here in just a moment. It's the way we react. Because sin takes a toll on the human psyche. It's a category that nobody else has. And anybody who's a psychologist or a counselor who studied this would say, you know what, I've never thought of it that way, but you're right. Because a 7-year-old, an 8-year-old who has been molested when she's 47 or he's 50, somehow they're still carrying that with them. And in their case, it wasn't even their sin. It was somebody else's. But you're still being impacted by it because sexual sin is different than any other. The consequences are different than any other. It's a fire that outside of its boundaries is extraordinarily destructive, but we already know that. And here's what he says, his explanation. I'm jumping back to verse 15. Don't you know? Obviously they didn't, or he wouldn't have said that. Don't you know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? It's not just our mind, emotion, and will, our soul that's part of God. It is not just our intellect and our emotions. It's not just our spirit. He says, don't you know that your body are members of Christ himself? We're his hands, we're his feet, we're his ears, we do his work. We're compassionate, we give, we're generous, we do the work of Christ on earth. Now your physical bodies as Christians are all part of that. Shall I then, he goes on to say, take the members of Christ? And then this was the word that just caused them to go, what are you talking about, Paul? What's the next word? Unite. Unite means to fasten, to glue, to permanently attach. Shall I take the members of this body that are Christ and shall I glue them with a prostitute? His audiences go, whoa, back up, Paul. We're not uniting, we're just having sex. Who said anything about gluing together? You're trying to make this a permanent thing. This was just a one-night stand. And Paul's going, oh yeah, you did because you don't understand God's design. You think it's physical. You think it's an activity, but it's not. This is about intimacy that God likes to have with us, and He wants us to have in the context of marriage. Paul's going on. Let me go on and explain. Verse 16, do you not know that he who unites himself with a prostitute is one with her body? But no, we're not. We just had this little deal. I mean, she doesn't know my name either. It's like spring break, Paul. I was only 18, you know. I was 24 and everybody else. And oh, man, no, not permanent. And Paul goes on, oh, you didn't know, did you? You thought it was an activity. You thought it was an event. You thought it was a pastime. No, it's a pathway. You see, when you have sex with someone, there's a part of you that unites, that fastens, that glues. You become one with them. And when you separate, you take part of them with you and they take part of you, because there's something that's rather ongoing about this. You see, when we tweak what God has designed to allow us to be intimate, not just intimate physically, but this amazing thing called intimacy that links us together in marriage, in body, soul, and spirit. Paul then takes him all the way back to the book of Genesis to illustrate what he's talking about. He goes all the way back to Genesis chapter 2, and he says the two will become what? One. That's exactly what God said to Adam and Eve when he stacked the wood and he threw the gas on it. And he said, Adam, go for it. Two, as husband and wife, became one. Now here's the truth, and this explains some of our struggles. There is a oneness. We can never completely unone what happens in the oneness of sex. We rip it apart. We leave a little of us. We take a little, and it impacts our ability for ongoing expression and experience of intimacy. Have you ever in culture heard anybody talk like I'm talking to you today? Have you ever gone to a movie where people were doing things with lots of other people, and they said, you know what, when you leave that room with him or her, you're taking them with you, and when you enter that room with him or her, you're taking some of them, and you leave some of yourself behind? No, most of the movies have a happy ending, and most of the time, they're not that happy. Let's fast forward 20 years. All of a sudden, we carry all of this with us into a new relationship. You know this is true. You didn't even have these terms. You wouldn't have even thought this way, but we know. And because God designed it, God loves us, what else is He going to say except, look, guys, run from it? Why? Because it's dangerous and I might get sick? No. Why? Because I might get pregnant? No. I mean, we deal with all of that, but it's because God knows this is going to put a dent in our soul. It's going to mess with our ability to experience all that God wants us to experience. And listen how He wraps this up. Going back to the verse we ended with, verse 18, flee. All other sins a man commits are outside his body, but sexual sins are inside his own body. Paul is saying, God, the reason God put this in a separate category is because unlike any of the other sins, this is going to hurt you. It's going to hurt you far more than any else. So here's the deal. Some of you are saying, Tim, I hope you don't talk about this for another 2 years. Some of you are going to go out and say, hey, I'm 21, I'm 24, I'm 25. That 60-year-old preacher is not going to tell me how to live my life. And you're right. I don't want to tell you. God does, though. So here's a word I have for you today. Remember. If you're kind of dissing this whole subject, here's what I want to say to you. Remember. Remember what you've heard today, and 10 years from now, when you'll wake up in a heap, when you'll wake up distraught and in a mess, maybe you'll remember this message. And God says, flee. It's never too late to flee from immorality. For some of you who are here today, I have another word for you. Maybe you, there's something in you that says, you know, as uncomfortable as this sermon today has made me feel, it makes sense. I agree. And the evil one right now is trying to say, oh, no. It's okay. It's okay. I have a word for you. It also means to run away. It's an Old Testament word that one guy in the New Testament made really popular, John the Baptist. Repent. The sexual sin, though it carries with it some deeper consequence than the others because of what we've just read about, it has been dealt with at the cross like every other sin. But maybe you've kept that isolated as the guy with the chisel buried deep. There might be some of you who need to go home together as husband and wife and repent together. Some may need to repent personally. Repent means you take some drastic measures. Some of you may need to get rid of your computers and your internet for a while. Some of you who are singles here today, you might need to decide, you know what? This is convicting. Maybe you need to take a year away from dating. Take some time just for you and Christ to grow intimate with each other so that the next relationship you'll be prepared for the kind of intimacy that honors God. Let me wrap this up. Verse 20 says, listen to this. You are bought with a price. Therefore, honor God with your, read it with me, body. The blood Jesus poured out on a cross, the suffering that his body took, was for the sins of this body. The sins are not so grievous that we cannot recover from, but we only recover on the grounds of repentance. About 35 years ago, I was moved and motivated by a tall, skinny, old preacher from England. His name was John Hunter. And he shared at the end of a message how he would begin and end each day. And I have done my best throughout the years to let that be part of my mental running conversation with God. He said, as I get out of the bed in the morning, he said, I act as if my bed is a crucifix. When I lay myself down at night, I'm reminded it is here that I do business with God. And whether it's in your bed or in your car or in your office, maybe a prayer like this would be helpful. Honor God with your body. Oh God, I surrender to you my hands and my eyes. I surrender to you my feet. I surrender to you my mouth, and I want you to use this dying, decaying body to honor you somehow. I want to go where you want me to go. I want to say what you want me to say. I don't want to hear what you don't want me to hear, and I don't want to look at what you don't want me to look at. I want to honor you, Lord, with my body and whatever price I pay, and whatever I miss out on by honoring you with this body, I believe it's worth it in the long run, because I will not fall for the lie and the twist of our culture. Are you willing to do that? You won't regret it, I promise you. In time, because God is in this, He'll begin to heal you. I've seen it so many times. I've experienced God will enable you to experience intimacy, which is way better than just sex. God will prepare you for a better future, but it begins with repentance and a commitment to flee immorality, to honor God with your body. Don't fall for the lie. Sex is just physical. Let me wrap up with one other thought. Some of you are saying, Tim, have you looked at how old I am? Has nothing to do with it. And you have children and grandchildren, and maybe even great-grandchildren who need to hear from you, who've heard from God. My grandparents influenced my life significantly. Don't be a grandparent who says, nothing I can say. Yes, there is. And we need to learn to say it. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, this is not an easy sermon to preach. But it's easier to preach it than it is to live it. And God, I am so very grateful for the men and the women who spoke into my life as a teenager, who hammered away at me on this subject. I remember Gene Fry one night in a car going to Tulare. I'm 16 years old. He looks over at me and he says, Tim, are you sexually pure? Scared the bejabbers out of me. But Father, him asking me that on that day prompted me to wonder who else is going to ask me that question in the years to come. And I thought of that question at key moments in my life. Father, I pray that some teenagers who might be in here today will have some resolve. And I pray that some singles who are living in this culture where it's difficult to be single and pure, that they will run to you as they flee sexual immorality, and you will give them the strength to stand. And Father, I pray that you make us little itty-bitty lights in this dark world, the kind of lights that shine brightly. And we know we're not going to completely change this culture, and we know we're not going to reverse the trends, but I pray that you would use us to give others hope to know there's another way, to how to handle this incredible gift called sex. Father, thank you for the environment where we can talk about it, and thank you for the courage to talk about it. I surrender this to you in the name of Christ. Amen and amen. Okay, I'm still alive. I have not been stoned yet. I promise you it'll be at least 2 years before we're on this again.